sense of laughter and humor. This presentation is named Laughter is Serious Matter, Moving Beyond the Homo Clausus Conceptions of Laughter and Humor. Norbert Elias started working on the essay on laughter in 1956, when he wrote drafts for parts of this essay that has beginning and incomplete middle fragments, but it doesn't have a conclusion. So Elias did not propose a solution to the riddle of laughter. In his autobiographical notes on Lifetime, he foregrounded the importance of this project to his intellectual trajectory. In this draft, Elias wrote that laughter surely is more than an individual phenomenon and that it is a universal human behavior pattern suppressing ethnic and racial boundaries. In his autobiography, Elias noted that the importance of his medical education for construction of his theory. And if he had finished the essay on laughter, I'm sure that he would incorporate biological explanation of this phenomenon. He started the essay with descriptions of human facial expressions during laughter and followed up with four manuscript pages in which he described the evolution of facial muscles in reptiles and primates. These paragraphs are unfinished or they represent different versions of the same thought. In this paper, I have adopted the sociobiological perspective that laughter promotes grooming from distance. This means that we inherited the possibility to laugh in order to connect with other individuals, and the evolution of laughter could be explained similarly to social grooming in primates. Since grooming is more time consuming in the first picture than their grooming of primates, since grooming is more time consuming, laughter enabled connecting with more than just one individual. Many philosophers and psychologists have begun discussing this topic by declaring words to the effect that humans are the laughing animal. But we are not the only species that laughs, as Elias noted. And this is known since Darwin, who's the expression of the emotions in men and animals, noted that anthropoid apes, when tickled under the armpits, will make a sound corresponding to our laughter. There are detectable acoustic differences between human laughter and that of primates. Elias wrote that we all smile and laugh occasionally. To do so is much part of a normal human existence as to eat or drink. Although humans may have inherited the capacity to eat or drink, it also may be that the case that every society has customs, taboos, and rituals associated with eating and drinking. The same logic applies to laughter and humor, that in every society there are norms and customs that structure biological mechanism of laughter, and this is proved by conversational and historical analysis on laughter that shows that every century has its own rules for what is considered funny. In his draft, Elias presented different ideas about laughter through history. Even though he didn't use the same distinction of theories of laughter that were used in this paper, the distinction on superiority, incongruity, and relief theories is the most common in literature of philosophy of laughter. Elias mentioned Hobbes, Locke, Spencer, Kant, and many other authors that based their theories on Homo Clausus conceptions of human nature. The problem is that these theories are not exactly, it is not clear, are these theories about laughter or about humor? Laughter may be defined as a fundamental human behavior with a strong social aspect that is often but not necessarily related to humor. In short, it seems like Elias was trying to solve the riddle of laughter in the similar way Bergson and Freud did. From Bergson, several ideas are important for understanding of laughter, such as its disciplinary role, which means that laughing at others, we laugh at others when they do not conform to prevalent norms. He also noted the cruelty of laughter, and this considers the idea that we have a momentary anesthesia of heart, which means that we are not empathic when we laugh at certain object of our laughter. And at last, he noted the idea that laughter may fulfill a social function. On the other hand, Freud teaches that the social world makes demands on its members, and that humor becomes a way of evading those norms and those demands, and at least momentarily. Freud also wrote that joke often represents a form of aggressive or obscene instinct that is actually packed into a joke. And this is the same logic Elias used in the civilizing process. A theoretical distinction could be made between rebellious and disciplinary functions, the one that that Freud considered and the other that Bergson considered. And these functions of laughter in practice may be difficult to distinguish between those two. And these concepts could be connected to the Elias dynamics concept of power. In this regard, the certain behavior, respectively, laughing, is connected to the power of figurations, which is the core of Elias' theory. This brings the argument to some of the central issues of social theory, namely to the nature of the social order and its power over social actors. It is suggested that social theorists have had difficulties explaining how social life maintains its hold over social actors, and Elias' theory in the civilizing process could help here, especially the idea of the shame and embarrassment as the main social emotions. The second idea in this paper is that there is a process of intellectualizing or civilizing humor and laughter. For example, comparison of early modern jest books with modern joke books shows that there have been a certain shift from action to words, or towards more detached and abstract forms of humor. Jest books could be understood as a description of humor of clowns, which is nowadays a childish sort of humor, where a laugh is directly provoked by certain behavior, for example, falling over one's own feet or doing things backwards. And in jokes, which are modern construct, the key elements that provokes laughter are words, namely punchline of a joke. This is the same logic that Elias showed what happened with books of etiquette. The certain commands in medieval text later could be found only in etiquette books for children. The third idea in this paper is the process of civilizing laughter is the same as the idea Elias used to describe what happened through history of sport. The main point is that sport, namely repressed aggression that needs an outlet, is placed in time and space that is restricted by certain norms. Humor and laughter are also restricted by prevalent norms and are given special time and place. For example, there are conversational rules when to laugh, for example, at the end of a joke or when we feel when we find ourselves in an uncomfortable situation. So conversational analysis showed that there are certain frames. When we say, for example, have you heard the joke about whatever, that is the time when we bridge the serious world of conversation and that the joke is about to happen. Also, there are differences in taste of humor, which could be recognized as humor habitus. And today it is possible to talk about the sense of humor, which is also modern construct, as a certain form of quartertionality, or as a form of symbolic capital. Thank you for your attention.